Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Praise God, Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, boys and girls, we gather here this morning on the 29th Sunday of ordinary time. Thank the Lord for the many, many gifts that He gives to us. Sometimes we are forgetful to say thank you to the Lord. Now let us now acknowledge our sins as we celebrate the Holy Sacrifice of Mass on World Mission Sunday. Let us now acknowledge our sins, as I mentioned, to ask God to forgive us. Lord Jesus, who raised us to new life, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us of our sins. Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
And Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and blood. Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Hear my God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
And on earth, peace to your love and will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you. We glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
And let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Now please be seated as we open up our hearts and we will be
yeah.
always for all of you, remembering you in our prayers, unceasingly calling to mind your work of faith and labor of love, and endurance and hope of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before our God and Father, knowing, brothers and sisters loved by God, how you were chosen. For our gospel did not come to you in word alone, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with much conviction. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And use a little history.
Sometimes people think we're living under the rule of oppressive government today, but we're not. It's just our mindset. So when the Pharisees came to Jesus asking the question about who to give the money to, is it okay to pay Caesar his due? But the Pharisees were plotting how they might entrap Jesus in speech. So that phrase that our Lord says to the Pharisees, the scribes, and the Herodians, you are hypocrites. And truly they were, saying one thing and then thinking something else. And at that time, taxation, like I said today, it was a hot bottom topic. And the Pharisees thought this would be a clever strategy to entrap Jesus. Now, if Jesus supported paying taxes, he would come across as disloyal to the Jews. If he opposed it, then he would be accused of rebelling against Rome. Either way, one might say he was doomed. Jesus replied to the Pharisees, the Herodians, and the Sadducees, makes an important point. For people living in the first century, the Christians, who and the Jews who were to be followers of Christ, and there was a handful of Jews that became followers of Christ, they should meet both the civil and civic and religious obligations that each of the group of society were entitled to. What belongs to Caesar should be Caesar. What belongs to God should be God's. And you might say, what are our civic duties? And you know them as well as I do. But according to the Catechism of the Catholic Church, it's the duty of citizens to contribute, and it's a whole list of things, to the good of society in a spirit of truth, justice, and solidarity. And freedom, where we should be one. A lot of times we're not. And this includes a moral obligation to pay taxes, which some people try not to, to exercise the right to vote, which some people don't want to vote, because they say, well, good is it? My vote doesn't count. And to defend one's country. All three of those are important civic duties. And many people today don't follow through with those civic duties. What about our religious obligation? What exactly belongs to God? And you probably know. And it should be our entire selves, our entire being belongs to God. Regardless of nationality, citizenship, and we might say also religion, because there are people of different faiths. We are all made in the image of our Lord, the living God. So while we pay our taxes and cast our vote to fulfill our political obligations, and it's political obligations, we might say also moral obligations. We give to God what belongs to Him. And that involves surrender, as I mentioned, our entire lives. Participating wholeheartedly in Mass. Coming to Mass, that's an obligation, a weekly obligation. And there are many who come on the weekdays. And that's extra graces and blessings that are bestowed upon them. And also, to besides coming to pray here, but praying wholeheartedly, paying attention to the liturgy of the word, listening to the prayers, and watching with our entire being, our eyes, our hearts, our mind, the also a universal church. And if you, when you get the bulletin, you'll see that the Pope has asked, and I know you get envelopes that says the propagation of the faith, where you are, and that helps with the missions, to give to the missions, to evangelize the teachings of Christ. That's all part of our obligation, and that's important. So we need to give ourselves. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, our civic duty, and give to God everything. Everything. Because if we give ourselves to our Lord completely, everything falls through. Now, at the Masses yesterday, I made a couple comments, and it's for me to also make these comments to you, but beginning of Mass at 4 o'clock, one of my district ministers, I had mentioned, as she came up, I told her to turn around and take a good look at our the people here. And then during my homily, I walked over to her and I said, now, tell me what you saw when you came up and you turned around. And I guess I caught her off guard a little bit, but I think she knew that I was going to do that. And she said, well, at the 4 o'clock Mass, it seemed like it was a decent amount of people, maybe about a little less than what we see here. And she did mention that up front it was a little sparse because a lot of people were sitting in the back. This is good up front. And I said to her, see anything else that caught your attention? And she, not really, but then I sort of coaxed her and something was missing. But it's not really missing here. I'd like to see more of it, but it's not missing. But it was missing at the 4 o'clock for, I mean, except for a handful of people, a family that was sitting here. And that is, where are the young people? Where are the children? And I mentioned to them in about 5 years, and a lot of us, my age, and I'm, you know, I'm probably saying 76, you don't know how long God's going to keep me here in many ways. Okay? The Lord may call me to go up there. I hope not down there. Or the bishop may move me. But you know what? In 5 years, if we were still alive and we come here, are we? Why would we be coming here? Because if most of us die, who's going to replace us in our faith? Who's coming here? I know these young people will be that I see. You know why? Because of the families. They're bringing their children, and they're teaching their children about the faith. And the parents, you guys, have been taught by your parents, and they have instilled it into you about the faith. Maybe a little bit of fear of shame. You got to come with us. But in 5 years or so, we don't know, and I'm scared. Some of these churches, not just in the coal region, could be down in York area and other places, may be closed because of the lack of believers. They say they believe, but they're not here. I made a comment yesterday. And I've said that to a lot of our kids, even at Lord's or other places. Okay. Mount Carmel team did great, football players, hey, that was great. And Father Litzko and myself and other ministers, you know, we have masses or services for them, one that in the mornings before they play the game, and we bless them on the field. Some of you may see Father. God was going to do that. Okay, and, but do we see them? I'm not sure. I got to speak to Reverend Rose and Reverend Brown, the Protestant ministers, and also the other priests. Do we see them going to their churches and thanking the Lord for the gift of the gifts that God gave them? I know our guys do that. I see who play ball or who do extracurricular activities. Okay, and some of our cheerleaders, because we see these altar servers here. Okay, they come and they participate in school events and sports. Okay. Where are our children? Because they are the church. They are the church now, not just in a few years. Okay, that's my homily. We stand and sit down and press our hands.
Thank you.
involved in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, and in joyful celebration, we acclaim.
Amen.
David's command, for my divine teaching began to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant each of our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, and saved from all distress, as we await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and glory of your blessed now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, by peace I give you. Look not upon our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace in your name, and at once with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please stand. Let us pray. Grant our Lord, we pray, that benefiting from our participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what we give in this present age, and prepare for the gifts that are eternal. In Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
We now pray the prayer to St. Michael, the evil one. Like
9:21. In closing, we sing songs of 586, sing a new song.